Thank you for this Sabbath day. We thank you for all that you've done for us and all that you've given us. Be with us, keep us safe, fill us with your Spirit, and prepare us to meet you in the second coming. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, what I want to start out today is with Solomon and the temple that Solomon built. And picture the time of events is the temple is just finished, and they're going to have a dedication for the temple. And that's where we're going to start out looking. And if you would want to turn there, it's 2 Chronicles chapter 6. And the temple is just finished. And there's going to be the dedication for it. Well, let's look on 2 Chronicles chapter 6, verse 1 and 2. Then said Solomon, "The Lord has said that he would dwell in the thick darkness, but I have built a house and a habitation for thee and a place for thy dwelling forever." So Solomon had built a dwelling place for the Lord to dwell in, and he is blessing the people at this time. The rest of the chapter is a blessing that Solomon had said for the people. And if you get over to verse 13, this is an interesting spot here. Let me read verse 13. "For Solomon had made a brazen scaffold of 5 cubits long, 5 cubits breadth, 3 cubits high, and set it in the midst of the court. And upon it he stood and kneeled down upon his knees before all the congregation of Israel and spread his hands toward heaven." So this platform that he's standing on is 5 cubits by 5 cubits by 3. A cubit is around 18 inches. So that would make a platform that was about 8.5 feet square, which is going to be, over into here, square, and 3 feet high, or 4.5 feet high, almost to this. It's almost like if I was standing on this platform here, this podium, if the floor was level. I'm not going to jump up there so you can see what that looks like. But that's about how size that it was. And it said that he kneeled to pray and he stretched his hands to heaven. Now, I've never heard of anybody praying like that except in this particular instance. And I've known this for quite a while that this is what it said. And it was quite an interesting prayer position. So you see, he kneeled down and stretched his arms to heaven and says, "O God of Israel, there is none like thee in heaven nor on the earth." I don't know if he looked up or looked down when he did that. I don't have the rest of the prayer memorized. I'm not going to say it to you, but it's in chapter 7 and it goes, or chapter 6, and it goes through the end of chapter 6 to verse 42. All of that is the prayer that Solomon prayed. And at the end of the prayer, chapter 7, verse 1, it says, "Now when Solomon had made an end of praying, that fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, the glory of the Lord filled the house." So at the end of his prayer, fire came down and consumed the offering that they already had prepared there. The only other time that I know of something like this happening in a friendly sort of way, I mean, Sodom and Gomorrah fire came down, and that wasn't so friendly to those people. But Elisha on Mount Carmel, they had the contest there, and the prophets of Baal had prepared their altar and prayed to their god Baal, and then Elijah built the offering to the Lord. And he prayed to God, and at the end of his prayer, fire came down from heaven and consumed that offering, and as well the stones, even the stones. That was a pretty special fire. But that's what happened at this time here. The fire came down from heaven and consumed the offering that they had prepared for this. Well, they kept this feast for 7 days, And on the eighth day, Solomon sent them away. And that night, after the end of the eighth day, the Lord appeared to Solomon, and he said to him, and we find this in chapter 7, verse 12. And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said to him in a prayer, and said to him, I have heard thy prayer, and I have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven that it be no rain, if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sins, and I'll heal their land. Now the rest of it's not the prayer, but what God said to the answer of Solomon's prayer is the rest of that chapter. But I want to look especially at verse 14, which is up here on the screen. This is a very special verse, I think, and it's quite a promise from God. And the way I like to look at it is if you would say that if my people who are called by my name, and if my people would humble themselves, and if my people will pray and seek my face, and if my people will turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I'll forgive their sins and heal their land. You know, my Bible has, in the New Testament, the words of Jesus are in red. And some Bibles are, some aren't. But if the words of God in the Old Testament were in red, and I'd like to have a Bible that was that way, if that was, this verse would be in red, because these are the words of God. And it just doesn't get better than just hearing the words of God. These words to Solomon were a promise to him, and they're a promise to us as well. Each of the promises that are in the Old Testament are promises to us as well. There's a special verse I like in Galatians 3:29 that says, if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So if you are Christ, and what that really means, I think, to me, is that if you understand that Jesus was the Son of God, that he was God himself, if you understand that he died for our sins, that he will forgive our sins, and that he is coming back to take us away to be with him, then you see, if you are Christ, then you believe these things. And if that's the case, then the promises to Abraham, to Solomon, are promises to us as well, because we are Abraham's seed, just as Solomon was Abraham's seed. So these are the promises that are meant for us. So let's look at that verse again in kind of a piece at a time. This is one in verse 14. It says, if we are called by his name, if we are people that are called by his name, that means if we understand that God is as our shepherd and we are his sheep, I see that the verse up here, the Lord is my shepherd. If we really believe that the Lord is our shepherd, then we will hear his voice and we will come to him as the sheep comes to the shepherd's voice. When I was a youngster, I was raised in Iowa, off that direction some ways. And I lived on a farm and we had sheep. So I know something about sheep, but I'll tell you, Iowa sheep are not like Jewish sheep. They just didn't behave that way. I don't know if they're a little dumber than Jewish sheep or what, but they seem like they had a mind of their own. But as I was writing this and thinking about that, I thought, well, you know, I was just a kid then, and those sheep were actually my dad's sheep. And maybe they did hear his voice more than mine, because there's times when he would feed them or whatever, and they would come to him. So if we are like that, if we are like the sheep that hear the shepherd's voice and obey him, then that's what he wants us to do. Also, if we hear his voice, now I don't hear God's voice like Abraham did, or like Solomon did, or Paul, he heard God's voice. But you know, I do hear his voice when I read the Bible. I hear God's voice. When I read this verse, I hear God's voice, because God's voice is in the Bible. And if we read it, we can hear God's voice. So it says if we know him, if we are his people, and if we humble ourselves and pray, to humble yourself is to be not proud. Lucifer's start of his downfall, I believe, was from pride. And this is what he wants us to not be. He wants us to submit to God and to not be proud, to take the part of the servant. Jesus showed us by his example how to be a servant. It said he came to be a servant, not to be served. If you was to go to the library or a bookstore, you could find quite a section of what you would call self-help books, how to improve yourself, how to do things for by yourself. But you wouldn't find a very big section on how to be humble. It's really not something that people normally choose to do, to be humble. But this is God is saying that we should be humble, and we should seek his face. We should search after God. In Jeremiah, he says about God that if we search for him, we can find him. He's not hiding himself for us. He wants us to come to him, and he won't hide himself from us. It's like in the Garden of Eden after Adam and Eve had sinned, and Jesus came that afternoon. He searched for them. They hid from him, but he searched for them. And in all the time that we look for God, really the search is instigated by God, and he is searching for us. And we can know that we have eternal life by searching for him. And when we find him, that's when we know we have eternal life. And then he asks us to turn from our wicked ways. It says, do not regard iniquity in your heart. Don't love darkness more than light. In John chapter 3, when Jesus was talking to Nicodemus, a little later towards the end of the chapter, he said that men love darkness more than light. It's when they like the way they are, when they don't want to change. That's the wickedness that you should turn away from. That's where the unpardonable sin comes from. It's liking the way you are and not wanting to change, not listening to the Holy Spirit, and turning God away. So God said in this answer to this prayer that if you would do these things, if you would turn from your wicked ways, if you would seek his face and humble yourselves and know that you are his, then he would forgive your sins and heal your land. This is what we need to do in ourselves. We need to learn from something from this verse and apply it to ourselves. Because if we really don't do that, it doesn't do us any good to read these things if we just kind of pass them on by. If it doesn't make a change in our lives, if it doesn't help us. This is what I want to do this morning, is a way to apply this verse to ourselves to help us. And the way I want to do this is by looking at one of the parables of Jesus. And the parable I want to use is the one that's called the parable of the sower. This parable is found in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And I've arbitrarily chose Matthew to look at this. And it's found in Matthew chapter 13, verses 1 through 8. So let's just turn there and read that parable, Matthew 13, 1 through 8. The same day went Jesus out of the house and sat by the seaside, and the great multitudes were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a ship and sat, and the whole multitude stood on the shore. And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some of the seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. And some fell on the stony places, where there was not much earth, and forthwith they sprang up, because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. Some fell among the thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. But others fell to the good ground and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30-fold. This parable is in a place called the Sermon by the Sea. The biggest sermon that Jesus gave was in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, and it's called the Sermon on the Mount. But this is called the Sermon by the Sea, and this would be the second biggest sermon that Jesus told that we have recorded here. He taught this sermon mostly in parables. There were at least 10 parables that he told in this sermon. I'd like you to think about the situation. I like to look at the situations when things like this happen. So picture in your mind, if you would, a seashore. And let's say that it's kind of a roundy cove. It's just kind of like the church here. And this would be the edge of the water here. And Jesus was out here sitting in a boat. And the people were on the beach around here and maybe up on the hill behind him. There was quite a multitude. And that was sort of the situation. And he talked to them and he told them parables. And this first parable that he told them of the sower. And I want to look mostly at the soil in this parable, because that's what I want to focus on. There was four kinds of soil that he talked about here where the seed fell. That was number one was the wayside, number two the stony places, number three was among the thorns, and the fourth was the good soil. So the first soil, the hard packed, it was like a path along the edge of the field. In the field, and then a path down along, and the ground was packed down, and there wasn't any loose soil, so the seed that fell out onto that soil just laid there, and the birds came and ate it up. Now you might think, why did he sprinkle seeds on the hard-packed soil where it's not going to grow? But you got to think about how he did it. The way that person would sow seed in those days would have a pouch around your shoulder, and the seeds inside of there. And as they would walk along, they would reach in and some of their hand and then scatter out and then another. Maybe they didn't make that noise, I don't know. And as they sprinkled it out, see, the field would go right up to the edge and then there would be the path. So you want to plant seeds right up to the edge so there's naturally a few more going to fall out into the path. Now, sowing seed like this, I had an experience of myself doing this just a few weeks ago, maybe a month ago now, I don't remember the exact date. I thought I might tell you about that. As some of you know, maybe not everyone, I work at Almaco, which is over on this northwest corner of town. If you was to go out north of town on S-14, do you all know the road I'm talking about? You go under the railroad tracks up at the top of the hill. And at the top of the hill on the west side, there's some big buildings there. Those buildings all belong to Almaco. And the field in behind them belongs to them as well. And they plant corn and beans there. And last year they planted some wheat just so that they would have a place to test the planters that they build. They build planters and they have some ground to drive them over. And then they plant the crops so that later we have some crops to test the combines that they make with the corn or with soybeans. And there's still some standing there, and we've been using them all along this fall some. On the north edge of the field, there's a gravel road that goes west, and they left a pretty wide strip between where they planted and the edge of the field, bare. It's been bare all summer. And we had some the wheat that they had combined earlier, they'd planted a little strip there and they'd combined that, and that was sitting around in some buckets and some tubs, and it was equal to maybe 6 or 10 5-gallon buckets of wheat, and it was starting to get bugs in it. and they wanted to get rid of it, and they weren't going to sell it. It wasn't really much good for anything. So the one person in charge asked me if I would take that wheat out there and scatter it around on that bare strip of ground, which I did. And then they had a field cultivator that I hooked up and run back and forth and dug it in the ground. And I had a bucket that was like a ice cream bucket, 2.5 gallon that I held. And this is just what I did. I just held this and walked along and scattered the seeds. And then I'd go fill it back up again. It took me quite a few hours to do. If you was to drive out there and go up that gravel road and see that, it grew nice. It's about this tall. That whole strip up along that gravel road there. And if you was to look at that, you can imagine that I planted all that one handful at a time. It was quite an experience. And some of it went, when you planted along the edge, some of it went out into the grass where it didn't grow, which was like the path. Anyway, that's the hard packed path, number the first place. The second is in the stony places where the seeds went. Now, this wasn't just rocky ground. You might think stony places was just rocky ground, but really more what it was ledges of rock that came out into the field with a little bit of loose dirt over it, maybe a couple inches of loose dirt over top of the rocks, and it's pretty much solid. So the seed that would land on that wouldn't have any depth to grow, and it would dry out and die. In the third place, it was good enough soil, but there was thorns and weeds growing there, and the seed that fell among those, it would grow up, but it would be shaded by the weeds, and they would suck out the water out of the ground, and they would die. In the fourth place was the good soil. There was nothing wrong with this. It was nice, rich soil, and the seed would grow up and produce a nice crop, some 60, some 100, some 30-fold, depends, you know, but it would produce a nice crop. I like to look at this like it was layers, you might think. And it wasn't really that way, but I look at it that way. The hardest on the top, and then a little bit harder and a little bit better, and the really good soil down at the bottom, just kind of layers of soil. So the disciples was curious about what this parable meant, and they asked Jesus to explain this to them, and he did, but I think probably a little bit later in a more private situation, he told them what the parable meant. And this is in verses, in same chapter 13, this is in verses 18 through 23. So let's look at those verses. Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and understands it not, then comes the wicked one and catches away that which was sown in the heart. This is he that receives seed by the wayside. And he that received the seed in stony places, the same came and he hears the word, and on with joy received it, yet hath he not root in himself, but dureth for a while. For when tribulation and persecution arises because of the word, by and by he is offended. He also that received the seed among the thorns is he that hears the word, and the cares of the world and deceitfulness of the riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. But he that received the seed to the good ground is he that hears the word and understands it, which also beareth fruit, bringing forth some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. So that was the explanation that Jesus gave for the parable that he was talking about. But as Jesus explains this parable, what he's showing them is that the soil is the seed, or the soil is people, and the seed is the word of God, but he's describing the people as the soil. If you look at that the same way from the top to bottom, as I looked at the layers of soil, there's people that didn't want to hear the word, and some did a little bit, and some more, and some on the bottom, the really rich soil, they heard the word and they brought forth fruit. So let's look again at this whole situation. As before, but looking at the soil as people and different kind of people. So the first was the wayside people. They are those hearers upon whom the truth of the gospel has no effect. There's a Chinese proverb that says, what enters the east ear exits through the west ear. Just goes right through. They do not realize, this is the wayside people, they do not realize their personal need of the gospel. They are inattentive. They do not understand. The truth doesn't seem to make any sense to them. The birds, or the wicked one, soon takes it away. That's the wayside people. Then the stony places people. There is enough soil to germinate, but the effect is superficial. The gospel appeals to their emotions. They are quick to react to it, but the impression soon fades. Selfishness prevents the gospel from having any real reform in their lives. Any effort to serve Christ is hindered by the real purpose of in life, that is to serve themselves. They see that the message is good, but they don't let the principles of the gospel change their lives. They're willing to face the fact that their habits, they are unwilling to change, to face the facts that their habits must be changed. Now, I unfortunately saw that happen one time just exactly like that. I thought I'd tell you about this. Where I worked there at Almaco a number of years ago, there was a young man named Tim. I won't mention his last name since I think he lived in Nevada. Who knows? Maybe you know him. So I don't want to talk about somebody you know. But we talked about religious things once in a while. Somehow we had gotten into talking about this. I believe it might have started once when there was a death in his family. And I talked to him a little bit about that. But at that time, really more than now because of my circumstances, I like to listen to cassette tapes. So you can see this was quite a while ago. Any of you still know what cassette tapes are? Maybe somebody does. Anyway, I had a little player that I put in my shirt pocket and headphones, and I could listen to things. And I listened to a lot of things. I have the Bible on cassette tapes. I used to listen to that each January. I could go through the whole Bible in January. I've done that several times. And I had other things. And one thing that I especially liked was The Desire of Ages on cassette tapes. And I listened to that a lot of times. And it's a great book. I recommend that you read The Desire of Ages or listen to it if somebody will read it to you. Anyway, as I was listening to this, and I don't remember exactly how the circumstances was, whether he asked me what I'm listening to or what, so I put the headphones on him and let him listen a little bit. And at any rate, as it turns out, he was willing to listen to this. So what I did was I bought him one of these little cassette players. They're pretty cheap. And a set of cassettes of The Desire of Ages and gave it to him. Well, he listened to the whole thing all the way through. And then later, a little later, he was telling me, he says, he started listening to it again. He says, it's amazing how much more you can hear the second time. And that's true. You can hear more the 10th time or the 20th time if you'll do it that many times. I know you can. But he told me, he said that when you hear something like this, if you want to keep on with this, that you would have to change your life. And he said, I'm not willing to do that at this time. Well, it wasn't too long after that that he quit there and took a job somewhere else. I haven't seen him since. I don't know what's become of it. Anyway, that's the stony place hearers. Among the thorns people. As the soil gets better, so does the response to the gospel. They make what appears to be a real start, and apparently they experience justification and the new birth. But they soon become very weary and do not continue to grow. The pleasures and attractions of the life they have been used to become temptations that they respond to. Many things that attract the thorny ground hearers may not themselves be harmful, but such persons become so absorbed in this world that they have no time to prepare for the next. The thorns makes it impossible for them to mature. And then we have the good ground hearers. The good ground produces fruit because the people let God work in their hearts and they respond, as Philippians 2:13 says, "It is God which works in both in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure." The good ground responds to the softening influence of the Holy Spirit and bears much fruit. So now let's bring this home. How this affects us. I have two verses that I'd like to read to you, and I have them marked here. I'm going to read them quick. You don't really need to follow on the screen with this, because I'm sure you know the verses anywhere. Anyway, the first one is in Matthew 28:19-20, and it says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I command you, and lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the world." And the second one is in Romans 10:14-15, and it says, "How then shall they call on him whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him and who they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things." So you see from these verses, it's our duty, even more, it's our privilege to bring the gospel to people. This is why we have evangelistic meetings or give Bible studies. It's to bring the gospel to people so they can hear the word of God, so they can become followers of Jesus and have eternal life. This is why we do this. So I would look at these people that come to our meetings and listen to us as soil. They're like the soils in the parable. There's different layers of them. Some of them are not receptive at all. Some are a little bit more, some a little bit more, in different layers of people. And as we bring the gospel to them, then it's like bringing it to different levels of soil. And it's like the verse, if you could put up in 2 Chronicles 7:14 again, if you have that right handy. As we look at the people as soils, you see there it said that if his people do these things, that he will forgive their sins and heal their land. And I would look at their land as the soil. So if we help to have people see these things, if we can teach them who God is and who they are, if we can teach them to humble themselves and to seek God and turn from their wicked ways, then God will heal the soil. God will heal them. So each of us, during these meetings, no matter what part we have in them, the presenter or the guard greeters or everyone else that helps the people that come to learn to know God, then we become healers of the soil. We can help them to heal the hard-packed soil, to become soft and productive. We can heal the rocky soil to be deep and rich. We can take away the thorns and the weeds so they can thrive and grow. And we can help them to be productive and to bear much fruit. It's like God said to Solomon, I will heal their soil. We can all be healers of the soil. Thank you. Our closing song, Bringing in the Sheaves, is just part of this. We can help bring in the sheaves. I've asked other place before, I'll ask you, how many of you know, you've heard this song, haven't you? Bringing in the sheaves, probably a lot of times. How many of you know what sheaves are? Everybody? Not everybody. So I thought I would tell you. What sheaves are is when you, in the old days, they didn't have combines. Now you combine wheat, you just drive down through and take 20 or 30 feet at a time and cuts it and puts the grain in the hopper and stuff out the back. But in the old days, they cut it by hand. They would cut the wheat with a sickle by hand and tie it in bundles and then take these bundles into their farmyard and thresh them out. Well, these bundles of wheat are sheaves. It's no more than that. A sheave is just a bundle of wheat. So as we're bringing in the sheaves, we look at them as people, and we're bringing in the people.